Hello, welcome back to the Most Dangerous Podcast. How are you, James?
Good evening, Fraser. I'm not too bad. And how are you?
I'm good. Yeah, I'm good. Thanks. Yeah, how's your week been?
I quit my job.
You quit your job?
Yeah, I think I told you that, didn't I?
Well, yeah, so I was just pretending for the listeners that...
Yeah, I went in this morning and I thought, nah, I've had enough of this. Yeah, so I'm leaving. Do you know, I've got to give like 3 months notice though, you know, because I'm like a high hotshot lawyer.
Well, yeah.
It's none of these, like, there's none of this sort of month's notice anymore. It's 3 months, so I won't actually get to leave until August or the end of July.
I don't understand that, because if I was a boss and someone said, right, I'm leaving, but I'm going to work for the next 3 months, I just know I'm not going to get the full potential out of them for those 3 months.
Yeah, that's true, but I kind of get it as well, because, you know, they've got to get someone in. You know, I don't think they'll be able to replace me, but you know, they won't be able to get someone such a superstar. But yeah, I kind of do understand it, but it's annoying that I've gonna have to go in for the next 12 weeks.
Yeah.
And just kind of go, all right, I'm gonna have to finish all this stuff off now. Yeah, so that's a bit of news there. I do have something else lined up, so
that's good.
Yeah, I hope
podcasting,
that's the dream. Not yet.
I think, sorry, James, I was going to say, on that note, I'll tell you all, like, subscribe, share, do what you want, so that James doesn't have to go to his new job.
Yeah, please do.
Yeah. Auto-download, that's what I keep hearing, auto-download.
Oh, yeah? And how do you do that?
So, I know on Spotify, you basically click to anyone that you've subscribed to, and you can change the settings to auto-download, so that as soon as the episode's released, it downloads to your phone or whatever device you're using. And then if you're on the go and you've got no internet, you've already got our episode to listen to.
Right. I didn't even know about that, to be honest.
No, I know. So, but yeah, the listeners need to do it. Yeah,
do that. So, that's me, really. It's kind of like, it's a bit of a sad thing. I mean, it's a nice company that I work for. It'd be sad to leave everybody, but it's one of those, isn't it? Sometimes you just got to make the decision for yourself, I suppose. Otherwise, I'd be sat there forever going, bored.
That's it. You've got to move on to move up, haven't you? You know.
That's it. So enough about me. That's very boring. How about you? Have you been doing anything? Anything interesting?
I've had a busy week. I've done quite a lot of work this week. Yeah, just the usual, putting shutters on people's windows and
going to your lockup.
Going to my lockup. Yeah, feeding the prisoners and stuff. But I've got a wee thing to read out. Don't normally do this, but I was on Facebook. Just browsing through, as you do, sitting looking at shit.
Yep.
And this really tickled me. There's a page called Scottish Banter.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Yeah, quite a few people. It's got quite a lot of followers, and it's just funny things that Scottish people say. And it was basically someone had posted as an anonymous participant, and this is quite a serious post, but I've been laughing about it all day. It says, apologies if this post is not allowed, but I'm wanting to get to the bottom of this as I'm at my wit's end. I'm not sure who has been letting them into the building or if they live there, but for the past 3 weeks, someone has been opening my letterbox flap in the middle of the night and shouting, porridge! Sometimes it's porridge time, Papa Bear. Or once it was, eat it before it goes cold, Papa, this bit said in a whisper. It's my special porridge. Before you ask, no, porridge had not been left at any time. This is clearly an unwelcome visitor, and I want it to stop ASAP. If this is you, grow up.
That's very sinister, isn't it?
Yeah.
I wouldn't like that at all. That'd really freak me out. Did he say it was a block of flats?
It sounds like, yeah. I mean, where it is in Glasgow, it's all basically blocks of flats. So I imagine it's either someone within the building, which is probably more likely than someone managing to get in every night about midnight or whatever.
I wonder why they're targeting him.
I don't know. It's just a fact. It's not even, I'm going to kill you or you're a wanker. It's porridge.
Porridge? Oh, yeah, that's very annoying. I wouldn't like that. I don't blame him.
There was a wee story in the Chester Standard years ago about this company, and every Monday morning, it was a business in the middle of Chester, an office block. Mm-hmm. And every Monday morning when they got there, there was a big jobby on the doorstep, right in front of the door, big human jobby. and they couldn't get to the bottom of it. So after a wee while, they set up a security camera. And it was Sunday, a late Sunday night, this wee old guy comes up, newspaper and everything, squats over on the step, does a big jobby, wipes his bum, walks away. And it turned out it was a security guard that had worked with him for years, and they made him redundant. So like after that, every Sunday night, he was like, right, I'm going to go do a big jobby on your...
Yeah, job. Revenge shifting, yeah. Good on him. I like that.
Nah, yeah. I'm all for that.
Phantom shitter.
Aye.
Yeah, all right, well, cool.
Bit of weird stuff there, but yeah. I just, that story, I mean, a lot of stuff makes you laugh on Facebook. Something really just tickled me about that.
Yeah. I don't think I'll be doing that to my work. They're quite nice.
No, no.
And they haven't made me redundant.
You like stories about haunted locations, or maybe tales of cryptids and spooky folklore from around the world? If so, why not tune in to Haunted Escapes with Chris and Diane, where all this and more will be discussed. New episodes drop every Sunday, the visual versions the following Friday on YouTube. So why not come join us on our Haunted Escapes?
So as it's my week to do my story, James, it's your week to do your dangerous news.
It is, yeah, dangerous news. Beep, 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 beep. Did we get any messages about that? About whether it was annoying?
No, but someone actually asked me, a friend of mine, Tyler, he sent me a random message, I hadn't spoken to him for a wee while, basically saying, does James do that fresh every week or is it a recording? I said, no, he does it fresh every week, nails it every time.
All right, okay. So, there's at least one fan, maybe.
So just as I've mentioned him, hello, Tyler. Thanks for listening.
Yeah, cheers.
Do you know, another thing, sorry, I know we've just done your dangerous news. Our listeners are growing all the time, and someone that I hadn't spoke to for 3 or 4 years, someone that used to work with us, sent me a completely random WhatsApp message, first time I'd heard him in 2 or 3 years, and it was just a picture of a finger and then a picture of a pirate.
Okay.
And I thought, wow, he's listening to the pod.
Wow, what was that from?
My SeaWorld experience.
Oh, yeah. I remember now.
Yeah, just no message, nothing, just a pointing finger and a pirate.
Hey, right, well, yeah, well spotted, well listened. Right then, Fraser, this week's dangerous news. It was a bit light on the news. Well, it's going to be a bit light on the news this week, to be honest. I couldn't find that much. There's not much weird stuff been going on this week, I don't think. But I've got a couple. Well, I've got a few little stories. Excellent. For you. So this first one, a ram. This is from the New Zealand Herald. I think we should start kind of referencing where they come from. Because
yes.
So this is from the New Zealand Herald. A ram believed to be responsible for killing an elderly couple has been shot dead by New Zealand police. So, I don't know, it's harsh, isn't it?
Yeah.
So, the pair in their 80s were found dead by their son in a paddock attached to their home in West Auckland, New Zealand. The son had grown concerned after not hearing from his parents that morning, spokesperson said. Police attended the scene at 7:30 a.m. local time and confirmed the ram was in the paddock at the time of their visit. The county's force said in a statement, another party at the scene suffered minor injury after being attacked by this ram. It added that the officers were confronted and approached by the ram, and after assessing the situation, they shot the ram dead.
Oh,
no, yeah. It doesn't actually go into detail of how it killed this couple, to be honest.
I assume it rammed them.
Well, yeah, does what it says in the tin there, yeah. Dave Burrell, a relative, told the Herald the couple had both lost their lives in a tragic accident. They're good people. They're over 80. They don't deserve this, said Mr. Burrell. Everyone is shocked as to what's happened. They're very upset. I feel like I was dreaming it, actually. It was a bit of a shock being told what happened. I just didn't believe it. And there's an investigation underway into the deaths and a post-mortem is expected.
Bloody hell.
So, yeah. So, three deaths there. Two elderly people and a ram.
Yeah, yeah. Poor ram.
So, poor ram, yeah. Poor people as well.
I love... I like, you know, a lot of people getting hurt on the internet. We've talked about this. And one of my funniest ones is when kids get, like, rammed by a goat or a sheep or something.
Yeah.
And when they've been, like, poking it in the eye and stuff, and they turn around, it runs up behind them. And
that happened to me once when I was a kid.
Yeah?
Yeah, it wasn't a nice experience because they're just relentless. Like, they just don't stop.
Yeah, yeah.
And I also got bit by a chicken on the finger.
Wow.
I was poking my finger in a chicken's face and it bit me.
They probably deserved it then.
Yeah, probably. I was only like young though. should have given me the benefit of the doubt.
I got bit in the shoulder by a horse. That was sore.
Was I there that time?
No, I don't know. No. Maybe.
I remember when, like, your dad got bit by a horse. He's putting his hand right in the horse's mouth, going, "Oh, look, it's sucking me!" And he's like,
"I remember that of the Duke's Drive."
You fucking bastard!
Do you know, my dad in his later years, he decided to get back into horse riding, something he loved when he was a kid.
Oh yeah.
And so he decided, instead of my dad being my dad, was like, "Oh, instead of getting like a, you know, a nice calm horse, I know a place where you can get like retired race horses, like dead cheap before they go to the glue factory."
All right.
So he got this horse. It was called Jimmy, funnily enough. And so he gets this big horse, big black horse, beautiful big thing. And he's going on about, "Oh, you should see this horse. I've basically only had to pay an adoption fee and I've got a stable for it and everything. Jimmy, beautiful horse, beautiful." People are going, "You know, you don't know anything about it." "No, it's fine, it's fine." So he booked a vet to come and check it out. So the vet came, an hour's, you know, health check, heart rate, all this sort of stuff, take bloods and everything. That night he was like, "Oh, my horse, Jimmy, absolute clean bill of health. What a find, what a fantastic fucking find." Next morning he gets up, goes down there, and it was lying dead in the floor of the stable.
Oh, bloody hell.
just died.
Yeah, I kind of knew that was coming, and then like a thought went into my head. What do you do with a dead horse?
Get out, glue factory.
Where do they go? You know, what does the vet come and get them? They're big, aren't they?
Yeah, I suppose there must be a place that takes them away. I know when my dogs have died, there's a funeral home in Hollywell, and they literally come and pick them up from the vets and
cremate them. Yeah, a dog's a dog, like, but a horse, like, you need a proper, like, trailer and
truck
stuff.
And a flatbed.
Never thought of that. Yeah, wonder what happens there.
I don't know. Sadly, I can't ask my dad.
All right, then. So for our second story, do you know I mentioned this one last week about the hedgehog?
Yes, I've been waiting for this.
Yeah, so this is from last week. It's from The Guardian, this one. So a hedgehog that has swollen to the size of a football, it was so big that it was spotted in a field by passengers on a passing bus.
What the hell?
It has been deflated by rescuers.
It was the straw up its bum, or
this is a real thing. Yeah, so the female hedgehog, which has been named Bounce, had blown up to twice its normal size when it was seen in Gloucestershire.
Wow.
It was taken in by the charity Wild Hogs Hedgehog Rescue. Respect to them.
Yeah.
And diagnosed with Bloon syndrome. it's a real thing.
It sounds like a theme hospital. You know,
yeah, yeah.
Slack tongue, bloated head.
Bloated head, that was the one, wasn't it? So this is where air gets into a gap between the skin and the creature's musculoskeletal structure.
Shit.
So it's unique to hedgehogs. So this is what the charity's manager, Emily Harper, said.
Mm-hmm.
She said, Bloon syndrome is unique to hedgehogs. They have a gap between their skin and the musculoskeletal structure of their body. If a wound occurs, then an infection can get into the gap. The outside of the skin heals over. And then the infection's trapped inside and it releases gases which cause the hedgehog to bloom.
Bloody hell.
Yeah, it's extremely painful and is fatal if not treated. But
shit.
Bounce, luckily, has been deflated. And the charity hopes that she will make a full recovery and be returned to the wild.
Fantastic.
So that's good news. Well done, Wild Hogs Hedgehog Rescue, for your efforts there. But there are pictures doing the rounds. Maybe you could fish one out for the Facebook page.
I will
but
do.
Yeah. It does look pretty painful, to be fair. Like, it is the size of a football, a big spiky.
It looked
like a
puffer fish. Like,
yeah, bigger though, I suppose.
Yeah. Imagine if that blew up, that'd be lethal.
We spoke about this. Exploded hedgehogs. Some point down the road. Hopefully Bounce will be back bouncing around soon enough.
Good luck, Bounce.
And this one's... Sorry, this is really weak. Like I said, I couldn't find much. Finally, this is from Sky News. NASA have been asked to help in the search for the Loch Ness Monster. The Loch Ness Centre has urged the space agency to lend its expertise in a fresh hunt for the legendary creature. Last year, one of the biggest searches of Loch Ness in the Highlands concluded with a hydrophone capturing of a loud underwater noise. Wow. And several potential sightings. The latest search will take place on the 90th anniversary of Sir Edward Mountain's expedition. Don't know what that is. From the 30th of May to the 2nd of June. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm guessing he must have done some expedition in Loch Ness, I guess.
Possibly, yeah.
Doesn't actually say. Since the first expedition in 1934, there have been over 1,156 sightings recorded on the official Loch Ness Monster Register. So Ness is on a register.
Bloody hell.
Not that sort of register, I don't think. Where are we? Amy Todd from the Loch Ness Centre said, "We are hoping that Nessie hunters around the world will help us reach the people at NASA. We're hoping to reach them through the power of social media, and we are just hoping for their expert guidance to help with our ongoing quest to get answers."
Hang on.
I know. You're going to say the same thing as me. Go on.
But there's like a whole news report here about them contacting NASA and basically what they're going to tweet them or something.
I don't know.
Like, trying to reach out to them through social media.
Yeah, well, I suppose the more exposure they get, the more likely someone from NASA will go, "Oh, look, they want to speak to us." I don't know why they just don't contact the HR, but there you go. There must be a contact address for NASA.
But NASA are really far away from the Loch.
Yeah, and also NASA deal with things up in the sky.
Yes. Yeah.
Whereas this is down in the ground. So I don't really understand.
Although my frying pan says it was developed by NASA, so...
Was it really?
Yeah.
So it wasn't.
Apparently that Teflon, you know, the non-stick coating...
Oh, yeah.
Apparently that was like a NASA... There's loads of stuff that they developed for... I think Velcro was...
Oh, I see what you mean, right, yeah. I get it. Not that they're using frying pans in space.
No.
Teflon frying pans, yeah.
Yeah, I'm sure Velcro was invented for space travel.
Yeah, right. I'm pretty sure, yeah, you're right. There's been a few things. It wasn't like a certain type of pen that was developed for...
Yeah, you can write upside down or something.
Yeah.
Good for the Australians.
Good one, yeah. Loch Ness, right? It's got a few facts about Loch Ness. I'm not going to bore you with them all.
Good.
But did you know it's about as deep as the Golden Gate Bridge in San Francisco? So from the top of the bridge to the bottom of the bridge, that's how deep.
The
loch is.
It's the deepest and biggest loch in Britain, isn't it?
No, it's the second. Loch Mora is the biggest.
Right.
Deepest. That's the deepest. Loch Ness is the biggest.
Yes, yeah.
Yeah. And but it contains, by volume, it contains more fresh water than all the lakes in England and Wales combined.
Wow.
So there you go.
I looked at it, though. It's a little bit of a cheat because it separates the whole of Scotland. It almost goes from the... one ocean to the other.
The
Irish Sea to the Arctic Ocean.
Right, yeah. Yeah, is it that one that goes sort of like...
it goes like right down. Is it really a lake or is it just a big crack right across Scotland?
Have you been?
No.
It's disappointing. It's your neck of the woods, that, isn't it?
It is. I've been right up the west coast. I've never been over to where Loch Ness is.
Yeah, it looks quite good. It's miles away, though, isn't it?
Yeah.
And before we finish off the news, what are your thoughts on Nessie?
Nessie? No, Nessie's real, definitely.
Really?
Yeah, I believe there's something in there. I don't think it looks like, you know, like a... It always looks like one of them, like brachiosauruses or something, the big long neck and stuff like that. I think there's something in there, big giant squid or something like that. I don't know.
They're weird, aren't they?
Too many sightings of something for there to be nothing.
Well, I don't know. Not enough evidence for me.
Yeah, no.
Right, okay, well, that's it. That's this week's Dangerous News.
Thank you, James. Thank you.
Hey, I'm Jen.
And I'm Sam.
And we're
Death Before Booze.
Our favorite thing to do is to tell each other outrageous stories and to see how the other one is going to react.
I figure we probably aren't the only ones who want to hear crazy stuff, so we started a podcast.
Yup. We're two friends who love all things true crime, paranormal, weird, and just plain sinister.
If any of that sounds like it's up your alley, every Tuesday, come on and join us for new stories, chats, and mostly laughs.
And you can find us on Spotify, Apple Podcast, iHeartRadio, and Amazon.
Grab a friend, grab your booze, and join us.
Yep, and always stay spooky.
Right then, Fraser. So as per usual, it was my week last week, and now it's been down to you to come up with a tale for us this week. So what have you got?
So before we start, I just want to put a little disclaimer and sort of trigger warning out there that this story does include sexual violence, it includes death, including infants, and if you don't think that that's something you'll be able to listen to, then maybe give this one a miss, and we'll be back to normal stories next week.
All right, so you've picked a good one this week then.
Good one,
I can tell already.
So I'll give you a short background on this. I was actually looking, I wanted to try and find, I read a lot of stories about the Nazis and sort of what went on in Auschwitz and stuff like that. And I wondered if there was other stuff like that that had gone on in the world that was lesser known, and I came across this.
So were you reading about that last week because we established you are a fascist and... You're just reading up on it, were you?
I was just reading. To be honest with you, I get fascinated sometimes with how sick people can be. Not that I get any pleasure from it. I can never get in the head of how these people can be like that towards other human beings. What's happened to your life so bad that you can actually do that? And it's almost like I hate seeing it because it drives me crazy, but you kind of want to learn more about it. And so I've always had a bit of an interest in things like the Holocaust and stuff to try and get in my head and understand how someone can actually want to do that to just innocent people.
I think it's important to remember these things because as horrific as they are, I think it's important just to keep it in people's memory. Otherwise it kind of just fades away into history, and for something so horrific, we don't want that to happen. It's important that it's carried through.
I read something that someone had said, and I'm paraphrasing, but it basically said deletion of history runs the risk of repeating history, and it's that we've got to learn lessons from stuff that went on.
Yeah, I agree with that 100%.
So right, so I'll get started. That's your last warning. So, James, have you ever heard, does the words Unit 731 mean anything to you?
Do you know what? It does, actually, yeah.
Yes.
I bet you were, you didn't think I was going to say yeah, did you?
I wasn't sure.
I do watch a lot of crap on YouTube and stuff. Is it the one in Japan?
Yes, it is.
Yeah, okay. I'll let you carry on.
Okay, so basically in the early 1900s, there was an area of what is now China called Manchuria. And at one point, Japan, Russia and China have all controlled this region. It connects to North Korea, it connects to Russia, and it is part of China nowadays. But as we know, years ago, Japan occupied Korea and Japan then overflowed into Manchuria. And during the Second World War, a large part of that was under Japanese control. During the wars between Japan, China and Russia, which a lot of them actually Japan won, despite being outnumbered, Japan were very innovative and, you know, they had better equipment than the other armies.
Yeah.
They the Japanese official realized that in a lot of conflicts and a lot of wars, disease was a bigger killer than the war itself. So instead of, and even like in the First World War, there was things, trench foot, there were all these diseases that killed the soldiers and slowed them down. Or if they got wounded, it was the infection from the wound that killed them as opposed to the wound itself.
I was just thinking then about the Japanese being like efficient and winning these wars. But then when they're against kind of like these battles, when they're against like Russia and China, I get the impression that those armies are just like, well, we've got shitloads of people, so let's just send loads and loads of people and just see how far we can get. Whereas Japan, on the other hand, perhaps their army wasn't as big. So they're kind of thinking, well, how, you know, well, there's no way we can beat an army the size of Russia's. So we've got to be innovative.
What?
So they've got to be innovative. What's the word again?
Innovative.
Innovative. So they've got to be innovative. Mm-hmm. And, you know, because they're not, there's no chance of them beating huge armies like Russia and China.
Absolutely. There was a little bit that I actually left out that, because I didn't want this to be too long, but I'll try and put in a nutshell exactly kind of what you've said, that Japan had to be innovative. But in the 1850s, Japan was still very, very much back in time from the likes of China and Russia. And they had an emperor at the time that said, I'm not having this. We need to become right at the forefront of innovation and technology. And as we know, Japan now are world leaders in technology. So by the time they were having these wars with China and Russia, they were sort of really, really advancing with their technologies. And I know 1900 technologies is different to what it is now, but yeah, like you said, they had massive countries, China and Russia, loads and loads of soldiers, and Japan basically outsmarted them. So yeah, so the Japanese military, they realized that disease was actually a big, big killer. And again, this is going back to them having to be more innovative. They were saying, right, if we can control the disease within our armies, we'll lose less soldiers, let them die of disease. We'll try and cure our soldiers and look after the disease, and essentially we'll have more soldiers in the long run. But they also decided that, well, hang on a minute, if disease kills more people than guns and bullets, then we could use disease to attack their armies. So they set up a research lab, and a man called Shiro Ishii was appointed in 1932 to head up this new bioweapons program in a place called Unit 731. Mm. It wasn't called that at first, it became Unit 731. So it was in 1932, Shiro Ishii, he was a military surgeon. Like I said, he was put in charge of this complex, and it was an absolutely huge place, 2 square mile complex. Wow. Massive, massive place.
I didn't realize it was that big.
Yes. So within Unit 731, there was some beneficial research, particularly in the early days, developing vaccines and cures for their own armies and for certain diseases. And there's stuff now that there's slightly good stuff that's come out of it that's still about now. But it did fast become a research facility of horrors.
Yeah, so I've heard.
So their biological weapons that they developed were based on fleas, little fleas from rats and
all right, you get them like animals,
cats. Yes. Yeah. And what they did, they worked out that they could collect these fleas from rats and breed them and infect them with disease and then use them as biological weapons.
God.
So to breed the fleas, they actually took Chinese prisoners and they made them wear suits that were lined with like straw and stuff, infested with fleas, so that the fleas would live on the humans and breed within these suits, and then they would harvest the fleas. They then got the fleas infected with the bubonic plague by putting them on infected rats, and actually created bombs made out of clay pots with flour and grain and all these fleas mixed in.
That doesn't sound like a very good idea to me, because like, there's no stopping that, is there?
No.
Like once it gets released into the population, mm-hmm. like I know like bombs are bad, you know, but at least they blow up and then that's the destruction.
That's it, yeah.
If you're releasing stuff like that into the population, there's no stopping it. Like, I mean, I think there is a cure for bubonic plague now, I think.
Yeah, I think nowadays there's vaccines and stuff like that.
Yeah, but even so, like, you know, you're causing a hell of a lot of chaos there.
Absolutely. They actually tested these bombs in the Manchuria region. There were still a lot of Chinese villages there, even though it was under Japanese control. So they tested these weapons by dropping them on these small Chinese villages. And they went back several weeks later, and it was just covered in bodies. Now, I think...
So they worked?
Yeah, they worked. They just infected them all with a plague. They reckon that there were 10 to 12 villages, little towns, villages that they tested them on.
Yeah, just wiped them out.
Yeah, that's it. And I think, I suppose the thing, where the town ends, the fleas can only travel so far, and eventually they die out. So it's not like a kind of COVID situation where it would just travel around the world.
Because they're like isolated villages, I suppose, with no self-contained sort of...
And travel then wasn't like it was now. So they were sort of contained, but most of the village died.
God.
But that was by no means the worst of Unit 731. They began to perform tests on Russian and Chinese men, women and children that were taken prisoners during their wars and scuffles between the three countries.
Mm-hmm.
And they started off with endurance tests, basically just to see how far you could push the human body. So some of the first experiments they did were to bleed people out. So they would actually bleed people out at different rates to see at what rate could someone bleed whilst producing enough blood to stay alive.
God.
How fast would someone bleed out with a limb amputated with, you know, certain cuts and so on. They starved people to different degrees. They fed people only certain types of food. You know, they starved them of fruit. They starved them of meat. They did tests to see how long people would live just without food altogether.
Yeah.
How long people would live without food and still getting water, but they swapped the water with salt water. They basically tested the human endurance. They actually referred to their prisoners as Maruta, which means logs, to dehumanize them. So every prisoner was called a log.
Yeah. Like a
wooden log.
I don't know how you could live with yourself if you were doing this to people.
It gets worse.
You know what I mean? Like,
I know.
Just off to work, love.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and then you do that all day, and then you come back and have a nice dinner with your family, and it's like, mate, your head's not right there.
No.
You know,
I was work.
Just killed a few babies. Sound.
Yeah. They used the prisoners to test their weapons for their army. What they would actually do is they had big fields, and they would tie people to stakes, different distances away from the likes of grenades, let the grenades off, see how far you had to be away to miss the shrapnel. They tied some up naked, some with clothes, some with military clothes, to see did the military clothes stop the shrapnel better than being naked. They tested flamethrowers in the same way.
Oh, gosh.
Both to see how quickly someone died with a flamethrower, how close you had to be to die from the flamethrower. And do you know the ones that survived? They then tested different methods of patching them up and making them better in case their own soldiers were caught with a flamethrower. And once they were better, they executed them.
As I mentioned, I have come across this before.
Mm-hmm.
And I might be jumping the gun a bit, but apparently if you went into that place as a prisoner, you're not coming out.
No one ever came out.
Yeah, it's a death sentence, basically.
Yes, yeah. They're actually saying that these people that had the weapons tested on them were the lucky ones.
Bloody hell, right.
There's no known survivor to this unit.
Yeah, apart from the scientists.
Apart from the scientists, yeah, which we'll come to at the end. They tested knives and swords. They sharpened them to different degrees to see how sharp they had to be to fully penetrate skin and bone. So there were actually people out there getting stabbed with blunt swords and knives to see if they could still stab. And they would line people up in a row to see how many people one bullet would go through at a time.
God.
So, yeah, you'd probably want to be at the front of that one, wouldn't you?
Yeah. Or the back. Well, you're going to die anyway, so.
Yeah, true. They did impact testing, where they would lie people on the floor and drop weights on them from different heights. to see what damage it did to the internal organs, and they even did this test on pregnant women to see the effect on the fetus.
Oh, God. I suppose they didn't drive over them, stuff like that.
They probably did. They probably did. They did centrifuge testing. So, like when you go into
spinning
space,
someone around. Like,
yeah. And they worked out that when you got to 14G, most people died.
It's good to know.
So that they knew that, you know, if they were going to fly a plane or something like that, then 14G was about as fast as someone could go. They did pressure testing, where they would put people in pressure chambers and crank up the pressure until they died, and they would also reduce the pressure until their eyes would pop out.
Explode.
Yep, and eventually die. And they experimented with transfusions. They would replace, say, a litre of blood with salt water. They would replace it with horse blood. Different things to
fucking
see.
Fucking hell. What is going on?
Yes, I know. Still not the worst yet.
Oh, God. What happens if you... Well, surely that's just death, though, isn't it? Like,
it is.
Salt water, you're dead.
Yeah.
Horse blood. I imagine the body would just reject the blood, wouldn't it? And you'd just die.
I think so, yeah, yeah.
I know that.
Yeah.
How come that? Do you know what? Why didn't they think of that? Why didn't they go, oh, do you know what? This is probably just going to, like, this isn't going to work. Let's just sack it off.
It feels like a real load of sick, sick people that were just bored, doesn't it?
Yeah. Like, oh, how about we just put some monster in this one?
Yeah.
See what happens.
Fill him up with gravy and see what he does.
Yeah.
And, The worst bit really was that most of these people had the experiments done to them. They were subjected to vivisection, which was obviously being dissected alive. And what they would do is the ones that had, say, an injury from the impact but didn't die, they would open them up alive just to see what effect the impact had had on their organs.
It had done to their organs, Jesus Christ.
Without anaesthetic. Without anything like that, they were just strapped to a table and sliced open alive. And there was there's a little story from one of the guards there that said a Chinese man was brought into a room and he just looked dejected. He knew that death was coming. He knew there was nothing he could do and he was quite calm. And he was fine when they strapped him to the table until the surgeon picked up the scalpel and he said that the scream that came out of him was like nothing he'd ever heard before. As he sliced him
fucking surprised, like.
Yeah. Sliced from throat to belly button and opened up whilst alive.
Jesus, man, that's like medieval shit, that.
Yeah, yeah. What they would do is, one of the experiments they actually did was to remove someone's arms and swap them with their legs.
There they did.
Just to see if they could reattach legs to shoulders and arms.
Oh,
to...
You can't laugh. Can't laugh. Like, it's horrible. But that's fucking... That is messing about, isn't it?
I'm sure there's a bit in The Simpsons with Dr. Nick Riviera that accidentally attaches a...
That's like, I don't know, like a Toy Story or something. You know, like this. That's what's his name? Sid. Where he's got those sort of messed up dolls and stuff. Shit, man. It's dark.
They would also remove organs, take someone's liver out, sew them back up, and watch them to see how long they lived before they died, and so on.
Jesus.
They did a lot of pregnancy tests, so the women were basically raped to forcibly get them pregnant, so that they could test on the fetuses, and they would dissect the women alive at different stages of pregnancy to see at what stage could they remove the fetus and it would stay alive, and obviously to perform tests. They would take the fetus out while it was still attached and perform tests on it.
Oh, it's just hell on earth.
Yes, there's another account of a lady that was knocked out with chloroform, and they opened her up and they were testing on her fetus, and she woke up and she knew what was going on and begged them to save her child's life, but they just gave her more chloroform and eventually she bled out and died along with her child.
Yeah, I mean, that's... At least she was asleep.
Yeah, yeah. For some of it.
Yeah. Oh, God. Horrendous.
They also did gas tests, where they would put people in gas chambers, And something they were interested in was, did people of different races and different ages survive different periods of time? So, for instance, did the Chinese people last longer than the Russians and so on? And there was another account of a woman and her daughter that were put in the gas chamber together to see if the mother lasted longer than the daughter. And right. I believe that there were actually people timing their convulsions to see who was, you know, further along than the other. And there was an account of someone that basically just said the mother just tried to shield her daughter from the gas, but they both eventually succumbed to it.
Yeah, there's only one. That was the aim all along, though. So what was going to happen.
But the women were mainly used as basically breeding stock to bring more fetuses in for them.
Don't know what to say about this.
I know. So, James, there was a leaflet that was found. There was very little found. A lot of this had been put together with accounts of people that worked there, because at the end of the Second World War, Japan just did everything they could to destroy any evidence of this facility.
I'm not surprised.
No.
Did they catch any of the scientists and stuff?
Yes, we'll come to that.
Okay, right.
We'll come to that.
Did they all have legs for arms?
Yeah. So one leaflet that survived was like an instruction leaflet that stated that an infant that was a couple of days old would tend to always have its hands balled up. I mean, you've had kids, they always got little fists when they're babies.
And they scratch their face and stuff, don't they?
Yeah, and it states that if you insert a needle into their third finger, the infant would tend to straighten its hand out, which made it easier for experimentation. One of the main
sit a needle anywhere in the hand and it'll go
hand. But it just shows, like, I mean, this is like an infant. How could someone
think that's all right?
It's, you know, the only thing I'd say about the infant would never remember it, you know.
Well, no, we'll probably be dead in like a week anyway.
True.
Do you know what I mean? Injecting it with ketamine or something mad.
Yeah. And one of the most sort of common tests they did on babies was to submerge them in ice water to see how long they lasted. So, a big fear of Japan was that if they went to war with Russia, they would have to go into the Siberian part of Russia? That part of Russia that's just all mountains and snow.
The big cold bit.
Yes. So they spent a lot of time on frostbite testing. And what they would do is they would get their prisoners to go outside and they would bare one arm and hold it out at the side. And every 20 minutes, they would pour freezing cold water over it. Now, bear in mind that this part of Japan, I suppose it was Japan, but it was China now. Yeah. The temperatures were hitting sort of minus 20. So every 20 minutes, they would go out and pour cold water over the bare arms until they were frozen solid. To know they were frozen solid, they would tap on them with a stick and hear if it sounded like wood. Mm. And they would use different methods to defrost them to see if there was any way to actually cure a frozen limb. And what was the best way to amputate it? So they would...
Flamethrower.
Flamethrower, yeah.
Flamethrower.
They would smash the limbs off. They would. They worked out that if you poured hot water over it, that was water was too hot, it just stripped the flesh off. Oh. And they worked out the water at 35 to 40 degrees, which is pretty much body temperature, was the best temperature to use to thaw out a frozen arm. Now, I've had cold hands. You've got to imagine these prisoners are standing out there with their arm frozen solid.
Literally, yeah.
Yeah, it's just...
Do you think if it was frozen solid, do you think it would shatter? Do you think your arm would actually shatter?
Yeah, I think anything would shatter if it's cold enough, I suppose. I don't know.
Yeah, I guess if all your blood... It's hard. I don't know. Because, if your blood and all that was frozen in your arm, then surely you'd die before that. Because you'd have shards of solid blood going through your veins.
Yeah, I suppose so.
It'd give you a heart attack or something, wouldn't it, maybe?
I've got some beef in the freezer. I'm going to go and hit it with a hammer and
slap your meat.
Yeah. They also did extensive tests on venereal disease, which was something that was quite common through soldiers, as you can imagine. And they would get infected men to rape other men and to rape women to see, test the spread of venereal disease. And they also wanted to get women pregnant by men that had venereal disease to see what effect it had on the child. And so these were your normal venereal disease, gonorrhea and all these sorts of things. One of the guards actually got infected by the disease during these tests. And but even though he was one of the Japanese guards, as soon as they knew he was infected, he was on the table and dissected alive.
What? Like, yeah. Relentless. Like,
that's it. There was
no matter who you are.
Yeah. There was no. I don't know what I'm trying to say. There was no discrimination.
That's what we were trying to say.
Yeah, it didn't matter who you were. It was all about, let's test him. Let's see what's going on. And yeah, he was dissected alive. I feel a little bit less sorry for him if he was one of the workers.
Yeah, it serves him right.
There was a story that I read of an older man, a man in his 60s, that they tested two different toxic gases on him, and he survived. They injected him with the plague, and he got ill, and he got better. They injected him with air, put air in his veins, and he survived it.
Jesus.
So they got a much bigger needle and injected more air into his veins, and he survived it. So they hung him from a tree.
Oh, man. You'd be like, you'd give him a badge and let him on his way, wouldn't you? You survived, you survived, what was it called again?
Area. Unit 731.
Unit 7, yeah, give him a t-shirt. Well done, mate.
A bit like, you know, like the Running Man, where it's meant to be like if you survive it, you get all these prizes and stuff. You know, the movie with... But the three guys that were supposed to have survived it, they actually find their bodies because they were never going to release them.
Yeah.
So that, I mean, that's the testing in a nutshell. But one of the other sort of scary things about Unit 731 is they actually did plan, in 1944, they had plans to drop these biological bombs on Southern California. Mm. And San Francisco, San Diego, all that sort of part of Southern California, very populated areas. And in 1944, they were on their way with a submarine to do it. And the submarine, when I say the submarine sank, that sounds daft, but it didn't come back up again.
Yeah, it went under.
Yeah, yeah. And they had another plan to do it, and they were actually just about to set off in 1945 to go and drop all these biological bombs on the Southern California when the Americans dropped the bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki.
Oh, right. Do you think the Americans had intelligence? Well, they surely had intelligence on this.
Possibly.
So what was on the submarine that didn't resurface?
It was the infected fleas, the bubonic plague.
Oh, right. So they're probably all dead now, aren't they?
Yeah.
It's not like a treasure trove of biological weapons on this submarine.
No, I don't think it would have survived. That's the story of Unit 731. What actually happened after the war was over was most of the stuff, like I said, it was destroyed and incinerated.
Yeah.
But Ishii himself and some researchers were captured by the USA.
Yeah, good.
No. The USA at first were like, what do we do with these guys? And then they
realized... Inject them with air.
Yeah.
Fire blast them with flamethrowers.
Good idea. What they actually realized is these guys had all this information. Because from all these horrific tests, there was obviously some valuable information. And the USA didn't want this information to get into the hands of the Russians, who the USA had strained relations with at the time. Mm-hmm. So Ishii himself and some of the sort of top researchers, they were granted immunity by the USA for handing over the information.
No, that's not how it works. It's like you give us the information and then you go and spend the rest of your life in a padded cell because you're clearly insane.
So they were actually, Ishii lived a normal life, went, got on with his life, granted immunity, never actually faced any consequences.
That's crazy. Hopefully he's in fucking hell now.
Yes. Some of the researchers were captured by the Russians, and they were a little bit less lenient. They were all given jail sentences of up to 25 years and basically forced to give them any information they had.
That's more like it.
But the longest any of them served was 7 years, and by the 1950s, all of them were released back to Japan and actually had a reunion.
Like a party?
Yep. A get-together, a reunion.
Like, oh, Jesus, that is just... Oh, I don't even know what to say. It's like, there's no justice there, is there?
No, none at all, none at all.
I mean, I get the information's valuable, mm-hmm. but there is like, and I'm all up for science, but obviously there is a bit of a balance there, you know? You can't kind of just go all in, you know? You can't be cutting people's legs off and see how long it takes for them to die. That's not good.
No. And particularly things like, I mean, the vivisection. Now, they seemed to believe that by doing it when the patient was conscious and alive, you got better results. But the conscious bit doesn't make sense to me. Why couldn't they have anesthetic? What difference does that make to what you find inside someone's body? It just seems like senseless pain and torture to dissect someone with no painkillers alive.
I'm guessing it's because they were trying to research what it would be like on the battlefield.
Maybe.
I think that perhaps on the battlefield you don't have access to, well, you suppose you get access to like painkillers, don't you? They have morphine pouches and stuff.
This was the 1930s, but I suppose they had war. I've seen World War films, they had morphine, didn't they?
Yeah. But I don't know, maybe that's, I mean, it's not trying to justify it by any stretch of the imagination.
No.
Saying that's maybe the reason, the rationale.
So, James, that's my story of Unit 731.
That's horrific. That's so awful. I'm lost for words, really. I mean, I did, like I said, I did know about it. I didn't know it was this bad. What can I say to that? I'm going to go and have a cry, I think.
I don't think there is anything that you can really say. It's just awful.
Is there any sort of like memorial or remembrance for these people that were sacrificed?
I honestly don't know.
No?
No.
I think there should be. I mean, you had the concentration camps, which were horrific. And then you've got this, which is equally, it's a really such, if I was going to say if not more so, but I can't really say that, can I? Because they're both absolutely horrendous. That's why it's so difficult to talk about, because it's just another level, you know, it's just another level of just inhumane bullshit. Like, I just don't understand how anybody could, unless... even with a gun to my head, like, I'd probably have to go, I can't do it. I can't do this.
I think the thing is, that's because death is more preferable than living with yourself after doing something like that.
Mm, yeah.
That, you know, like you said, how a lot of these researchers, they must have been sick, because how could you go back to your wife and kids and say, oh, guess what I did today?
Yeah, did you have a nice day in work, love? Mm. A great day, yeah.
I've researched more on this podcast than I think I have on all the rest put together, because I thought it was fascinating but also disturbing. And I had to keep listening to different videos, and I listened to two audiobooks, I can't remember what they were called. So I'll give them a shout out on the Facebook page. One was really good, one was shit. Just about Unit 731. And one of them was I actually listened to an 8-hour audiobook, and it still didn't cover it all. The stuff that went on, I've tried to pick out what I thought was relevant for tonight. It's, do people need to know about it? Maybe not. But I think that the more people that actually do know about these things, like the Holocaust and Unit 731, and some of the sick things people have done in the past, then it always gives them the opportunity to say, wow, let's make sure that never happens again.
Yeah, exactly. And with war as well, because I think a lot of people just go, oh, war, that's just like, you know, boots on the ground, so let's get fighting. But then this is the sort of the darker side of it, isn't it? You know, with the concentration camps and this research facility and things like that. And these things do happen when there's no sort of checks and balances in place, like the UN or whatever. So, yeah, that's... I'm shocked, man. I feel really down.
Only the highest elite of society are the ones that ever win from war.
It's very philosophical.
I know.
Okay, well, I think on that note,
I feel like we should
have a lie down.
I feel like we should tell a joke or something. No, I did. I thought that's a really serious subject. So I do promise our listeners that in 2 weeks' time, when I do another one, I'll try and find something a little bit more fun, maybe a spooky story or something.
Yeah, I'll try and lighten the mood a bit next week. Wow.
Why don't you do the Cambodian killing fields?
No, I don't want to do that. No more war, no more killing. Let's do something fun.
I could not do it when I saw it.
Fair enough.
Story.
No, I appreciate your efforts. Well researched, very interesting, very disturbing. And like you say, if you put more information up on the Facebook page, if people are interested, you can go and have a look. I know there's some weirdos out there who might want to read more about it. So, yeah, I think that's it from me anyway. Definitely from me. I'm lost for words.
I've got no more to say. I think I've said what I needed to do. So on that note, we'll say good night.
Yeah, good night.
That's been the most dangerous podcast. Thanks, James. Good night.
Well spotted, well listened.